Okay, that's the introductory commercial. I'm going to wait for everybody to get seated, and then we're going to get started. I'll begin by mentioning that in this building, 2 years ago, 40 former participants in the land claims negotiation process, people from all three parties to negotiations, First Nation, federal, and territorial, gathered in this building on a very cold January weekend, including a young person I see just arrived, Nadia, nice to see you, to address a big problem that all elders from three parties agreed was a problem. And that was that the spirit and intent of the agreements that we had negotiated and signed 30-some years previously seemed to be being lost. And indeed, a big concern was that many of the people responsible for implementing these agreements did not understand that spirit and intent, did not understand the core values, principles, key ideas in those agreements. Part of the problem we recognized was that the agreements were codified in a long 292-page text, which guaranteed that it probably not be read, or at least not by very many people, and perhaps by understood by even fewer of that number. And so we spent the weekend crafting a, we thought, we hoped, a plain English version of that 292-page document. And Leslie McCullough always gets mad at me for saying this, but my model was the constitution of the most powerful nation in the world, the United States, which is 12 pages long and taught in every class and every school in the United States at some point. So everybody, whether they have wrong ideas or right ideas, has some ideas about what it contains. And we came out of that weekend with a 9-page document. The old negotiators were supported by a remarkable group of journalists who had covered the negotiations in the late 80s and 90s and helped craft that 9-page document. We never intended it to be the last word on the subject. We intended it to be a subject for public discussion. And the plan was to create a website, put that document and other documents up there to further public education and public discussion. Unfortunately, something called COVID intervened, and we were not able to put that website up until today. And you will be able to find it on your websites at the First Principles Project, 48-40, if you and family and friends are interested. That weekend event, though, in January 2020, would not have been possible, though, without the active support of Grand Chief Peter Johnson. And I'd now like to call on Peter to open this event by saying a few words, either by, okay, there you are, you have your own mic.
Thank you. I just want to thank Tony for this opportunity, as well as all of you that are gathered here today and all the folks that are on Zoom call. My name is Peter Johnson, member of the Tuzumclinkit Council, and have been in the role of Grand Chief now for 6 years. And it's been such an honor for me not only to have this opportunity to come full circle, if you will, as my father and many other leaders back in 73 had the opportunity to propose together today for our children tomorrow. So I feel not only a sense of obligation, responsibility to help carry the torch, but also that sense of pride and sacrifice, dedication, all those big words that our people have utilized for in the interim for 50 years, but however, for over 500 years, we've been affected by not only globalization, but the need for economy, the need for commodity. And unfortunately, when we go back to those early times of contact, it was never done in a proper way, and very similar to our residential school situations if it only came across as First Nation people in a proper way, in a respectful way. Just look how far our people would have come. And however, the narrative doesn't speak to that, and we are now changing that narrative 50 years here in the context of the Yukon Territory. So Chapter 22 utilizes it in a proper tool, very similar to land use planning. Could be an effective tool not only for Yukon First Nations, but it helps support and develop economies and in small places in our communities that don't have very low population, but are very much looked upon from the globalization perspective as being rich in commodity, especially when it comes to mineral resources. And most recently, you know, over the last few years, we've recognized now that our culture and tourism opportunities here are just as strong as the mineral development, because at the end of the day, when we're able to tell our story from a traditional and cultural perspective and have people come in and celebrate it, and we could look at Hakusti'i or the Moosehide Gathering as very strong points of interest, we actually are in a better position, because for hundreds of years we haven't been able to tell our story to the full expectation that we'd like, and talk about where we've gone in order for people to understand what we've gone through and why we are here today in the situation where we're at. And it doesn't take much to walk down Third Avenue or be on Main Street to see our people still struggling and suffering from residential school, the Indian Act, the building of the Alaska Highway, the Gold Rush, all these monumental impacts that have happened here and occurred here in the territory. So when we talk about fairness and we talk about you people should be treated in a fair manner, just very similar to all the rest of Canadians, until we get to that place of fairness, it's never going to be that place of having that sense of equality. So why we have things such as a procurement policy now that reflects on us as First Nation governments and gives our people an opportunity to have maybe a little upper hand, especially when we're building a $60 million bridge in Teslin, that a few citizens could have maybe a little bit more of an opportunity than others from the south, let alone from other parts of the territory. It's only not only going to bode well for us as community, but also as our citizens. And the intent is for all of us to coexist. Our agreements are based on partnership. They're based on building relationship. They're based on co-governance models that are not only going to protect and serve for generations to come long after we're gone, but also to give us that sense of hope. And however, hope is not a method. We need to ensure that we're not only prepared, but we're also becoming more sophisticated, if you will, in contemporary ways of doing things here in the territory. So I really appreciate the opportunity when Tony and others that brought this proposal forward, because even myself, you know, even though I live in this world and I have for 20 years now in governance, I need to understand, and I look to people such as Dave and Tony and others to help not only give me a glimpse of what has happened throughout our history, but equally as important, as Tony mentioned, the spirit and intent behind these agreements. And as mentioned, we just want to be a part of society. We don't want to be the burden. We don't want to be the numbers that are projecting negative in the court system or in the justice system. And trust me, there's a lot of work that's happening. And I look at Gina, for instance, and her program and her support of building healthier, safer communities. Because we need everything to work in balance here. We can't have our culture and language without having the economy. We can't have our economy without having safety and health in our community. We can't have education systems where our children are growing up with already barriers that are holding them back from being the people that they can be. So when it comes to the economy, it's not only just dealing with how our GDP is or how many people have work. We have a foreign workers program that I think is missing a lot of the benefits of looking at our Indigenous population, our First Nation population, as being an opportunity where we can start looking at our next generation of young and up and coming First Nation kids as being the ones that will help lead the economy going forward. So could talk about this forever, and I appreciate that Tony has given me the mic for as long as I wanted, he said, but I think there's so much importance in this room. And I see a lot of people, such as Wendy Taylor, who is committed and, you know, that is buying into this forecast that we want to do. And we need government support. We need people support. We need industry support. We need everybody's support in order to fabricate something that's not only going to be tried and tested, regardless of which government's in place or which chief and council is in place, for that matter. But we need things that are going to be solidified for us. And just can't thank people such as Dave and Chief Isaac, Chief Morris, others that are on the Zoom call for their dedication to their communities as well, because without that dedication, we wouldn't be where we are today. So with that, Ngongchish, thank you very much for your time.
I assume this mic's working. Yes, good. So the particular focus of today's discussion is spirit and intent on Chapter 22. And around the table are people, all of whom have knowledge of or worked of experience in indirectly or directly with implementing Chapter 22. And I want to begin at the front end by starting talking about some of the success stories under the economic initiatives by First Nation development corporations, but also by their partners. Then I want to move on later down to some of the disappointments in Chapter 22, and we'll talk about that. But first, I want to go to the legendary negotiator of Yukon land claims and self-government, and I'm going to put a couple of questions to him, Dave Joe. And the first question, Dave, I want to ask is, it was a long journey to get to the treaty, Yukon treaties. Could you, using the mic that you've, or the magic, the talking stick beside you, what in your memory of that long journey were the high points and the low points? Could you talk a little bit about those from a historical point of view and on that journey?
Sure, I think that it's a historical journey for our people, of course. It didn't start in the 60s. It didn't start in the 1970s. It predated all of that. As a matter of fact, the first request for a land claim settlement was made by Chief Isaac during the time of the gold rush. He saw that his community was inundated with strangers demanding access to all of their resources in their, in his country. Secondly, in 1902, 4 years later, Chief Jim Boss from Ta'an saw the same thing for his people and basically said, we need a treaty. We need a treaty here in the Yukon Territory. Canada has been in the treaty-making process since the 1600s in the East Coast, and indeed adopted the number treaty-making process thereafter. But Canada had a policy of not treating with Yukon First Nations. So that's important to recall as well. Shortly thereafter, in 1941, of course, the construction of the Alaska Highway occurred. And again, our people were jeopardized, threatened in their own homelands with loss of resources, loss of jobs, loss of land, and basically ignored. And so prior to that date, though, in 1927, Canada adopted the Indian Act amendments that basically made it illegal for Indians to file a land claim, to retain legal counsel, indeed to even go to law school or to become a doctor or to vote. And those impediments, those legal impediments, those statutory impediments were not removed until 1951. And Canada was born supposedly in 1867. When did the First Nations across Canada get the right to vote? The most democratic freedom, the essence of democracy, is the right to vote. When did the First Nations get that right? Here in the Yukon and the rest of Canada. 1960, almost 100 years after. So you put in, not you per se, but Canada and the states put in a number of statutory impediments in that process, denying the most fundamental right in a democracy, the right to vote, till about 100 years after the birth of Canada. Now, of course, you're going to have problems with that. So in our case, our history is that in 1941 as well, a number of people came into the territory to construct the Alaska Highway, and that was very disruptive, of course. Also in 1965, the Tlingit Indians from the state of Alaska went to court, in which the US government established the National Tongass Force in their territory without speaking to the Tlingits who claimed they owned the land. They proceeded to a court case and they won, but they won a cash payment. It did not stop the Americans with respect to the establishment of that national force. And then thereafter, when we became involved, when Chief Smith became chief of Kwanlin Dun in 1966, here was a person who had fought in the Second World War to defend basically the basic premises of democracy, came back to the Yukon Territory, and it was against the law for him to own a piece of land in fee simple. It was against the law for him to vote. It was against the law for him to go into a bar. It basically was against the law for him to own a business without giving up his Indian status. So of course he got upset. There he was, putting his life on the line to defend against the basic premises of democracy in Canada. But when he came back to Canada, the country that he fought for, all of that was basically denied to him. And of course he was upset that unlike returning vets who were promised a section of land on their return, being an Indian person, he could not obtain that. Why? Because Indians were barred by statute from owning fee simple land during that period of time. And so in the 60s, he convinced the rest of the chiefs to begin to file a land claim, essentially, from the success of the Alaskan claim. And we knew the Nishkas had gone to court, but both at trial in the late 60s, they lost that trial on the basis of Aboriginal title. They lost on appeal because both the trial and the appeal court said if there was ever Aboriginal title, that title had been extinguished by adverse acts of the Crown. So we were afraid. They were on appeal to the Supreme Court of Canada. We knew we're up against that time frame. Because of the Supreme Court of Canada had ruled on that and confirmed the judgments from the appeal court, lower level court, to say that our Aboriginal title had been extinguished, it would have been game over for us. There'd be, what's the essence of our claim? A vacuous claim in law? So we tried to speed the process up. All of the chiefs agreed to file a document, a petition. It was a race against time for us to secure a meeting with Canada in 1973. And the Nishka case from the Supreme Court came out on January the 31st, 1973. And we had secured a meeting with Pierre Trudeau on Valentine's Day, 2 weeks thereafter, 1973. And that judgment, thank God, basically confirmed the existence of Aboriginal title. And the only issue becomes whether or not it was extinguished. So that strengthened our case, unlike the history in the province of BC where the Nishka was. We did not have a province or a colony that could employ adverse acts of the Crown that would extinguish our rights to the land. So when we met with Trudeau, when the chiefs met with Trudeau to present the document in 1973, essentially we were clear that our rights were set out, and if we wanted to proceed to court, we had a stronger case in law than the Anishka. And happily, Canada agreed to go. And so part of the highlights of all of that, though, was the presentation to Pierre Trudeau, who agreed at that point in time. The treaty-making process, the last treaty, was next door to us, July 21st, 1921. That was the last treaty. And then when Trudeau accepted on Valentine's Day, 1973, that was a new policy. There was no policy in place by Canada. He accepted without any policy in place. The comprehensive claim policy came into effect on August the 8th, 1973, and they had to formulate that policy after the acceptance by Pierre Trudeau. So that's sort of some of the highlights. And throughout that process of land claim, indeed we had ups and downs. We had the 84 agreement, which was rejected simply because there was a lack of self-government. There was an extinguishment policy in place that was adopted by Canada on all modern treaties. If you want a treaty, you're going to have to cede, release, and surrender your title to the land. In return, you get either a grant of fee simple or you get lands reserved for Indians in the context of a treaty. So those were, in essence, some of the highlights that got us there. And of course, we had to change many policies of Canada. We had to change the extinguishment policy. It took us 2 years, 84 to 86, to change that policy. And now we are the only First Nation group in Canada to retain Aboriginal title in our treaties. There's no other group that currently has that. All of the other groups have modified their title to be fee simple or get a grant back of fee simple. And so we managed to entrench as well. All of the other treaties ignored economic rights as part of their treaty. Our people insisted on Chapter 22 that we need a place in Canada. We need the entrenchment of economic rights. We want to ensure that our people are employed, have rights under contract. If there's any major developments in our land, if there's any hydro, we ought to be involved in the ownership of those projects. And so we were initially the first group that received Chapter 22, the economic rights, in the context of our final agreement. So I'll stop there.
Thank you, Dave. That was a wonderful short history. You should just turn that into a book and make a lot of money. So this process, this discussion today, is part of a process in which Gunter Business, Blair Hogan, Jesse Stephen, partners, have been retained to look at the implementation, successes and failures of Chapter 22 that Dave mentioned, and whether or not the spirit and intent of Chapter 22 have been maintained. So I'm going to go next to another, if I can, after I ask Dave's second question, to the big land question. But the second question I want to ask Dave before I move on is this. There are remarkable achievements you achieved in the negotiations of the Yukon land claim. The land quantum, collective title land, collectively held, which is more land, I don't think most Yukoners realize this, more land than is contained in all the reservations in all of Southern Canada. You have the first third order Aboriginal self-government agreements in Canada. And you have, as Dave mentioned, a chapter 22, which is in the process of transforming the Yukon economy. So the next question, Dave, is an easy question, but it's a trick question. So of those three achievements, which is the most important? Take that one, yeah. Okay.
Well, I think that's easy. The chiefs gave us easy instructions. The 84 agreement had a fair amount of land, but a whack of cash and no powers under self-government. And so they basically wisely said, we will reject that agreement in return for lawmaking capacities based upon agreements on self-government. And we'll take less cash up front, but more access to power over time. And the jurisdictions that we have are unique in Canada. We were the first ones to achieve exclusive lawmaking authority under the agreements over matters that were unique to us. Exclusive lawmaking authorities over our treaty rights. And of Champagne-Ajac, for example, they have the exclusive right to determine where all of their money goes from the treaty. If they wanted to cut me a check, forget about doing a book, Champagne-Ajac could transfer all of their money to me under their exclusive authority, if they could do that.
Hint, hint.
Oh no, I'm not asking for a pension, that's far too much. We also have the concurrent, paramount concurrent lawmaking authority over our citizens in the Yukon Territory. All the other First Nations in Canada have it confined to their settlement land. You know, even if we were to confine it in that fashion, just to the 16,060 square miles of land that we managed to achieve under the treaty, that is more than all of the reserve quantum in the rest of Canada. So even that would have achieved more than that. And lastly, we've got the paramount concurrent authority over all matters on our 16,060 square miles of land. The only thing that is concurrent is taxation powers with respect to income tax. Canada insisted upon that, and we decided to forego our rights under Section 87, the status Indian exemption of income tax payments earned on a reserve in return for all of that basket. And those were major achievements, and they wanted to achieve that. That was more important than the money. That was more important than the access to the opportunity under Chapter 22. Indeed, all of the agreements on self-government have a financial transfer agreement appended, and those payments annually, on average, range around 12 million to about 20 million a year to First Nations. And so that's the economic buy-in to what we know as Canada. And that to me is more important, and the chiefs wisely held out for that back-end load of the treaty agreements.
Thank you very much, David. Dave, we're going to go to another legendary figure, former Chief of Karkostagis First Nation, Mark Wedge. But Mark, I heard you give a speech recently to the YPO, Young Professionals, some of them didn't look that young, but I, but anyway, the Young Professionals Organization, about the thinking that your nation has been doing about land, largely rural lands, but how you're going to govern them. And would you take a few minutes to talk about that?
Thank you, Tony. Number of chapters I wanted to touch on. Chapter 2, mm-hmm. Chapter 11, Chapter 19, Chapter 22. But in order to talk about those chapters, I thought I would just sort of give some background, pick up from where Dave had sort of talked about some of those early stages and what some of the thinking was. A lot of times, just as we couldn't vote different things, we didn't have institutions. We couldn't rub two nickels together to get a loan from a bank because you didn't own the land, you didn't, right, you were on reserve, you couldn't seize property, you couldn't do all those things. So banks would not touch Indigenous people to provide loans to look at economic opportunities, right? And that was the big thing. The other thing is that a lot of the institutions that we work with, the Yukon Chamber of Commerce, the National Chamber of Commerce, the Tourism Association, a lot of those institutions that are set up to help with economic sort of opportunities and whatnot weren't accessible to the First Nations. So that's why we had to start creating Yukon Aboriginal Tourism Association, Yukon Aboriginal Business Association, which became the National Aboriginal Business Association. And those were institutions that we had to sort of work on to start developing, to start saying, how do we get things moving? The other thing that became very important is that when we started out, I think in 81, when there was a resolution up in Kluane area, when they talked about we need to get economic development going, they created Yukon Indian Development Corporation, which is a corporation that was really its mandate or task was how do we get economic opportunities starting to move in the Yukon with First Nations. So the first things we did is because we couldn't access capital, one of the things that needed to happen was starting Dunanai Ventures, which is turned into an Aboriginal Capital Corporation. Dunanai Ventures started out with about $300,000 from a community fund that we accessed. And then it began to grow into, it's quite substantial now. So, but what it did is it provided basic loans and some equity programs in order to start business. So we had to create that institution. We had to create that access to capital. Part of the other things that became important as we were starting to develop a lot of the capacity, we started this thing called the core option, because we started looking at what, how do we get organized? How do we start looking at this? And under the core options, there was four agencies or institutions that came together to start working on economic opportunities. We turned to CYI, which was then back then CYI, to start saying we need the political sort of intervention support to get it, right? We turned to Dene Netsedaton because we said we need a healing process because we need people, human resources and whatnot. Dene Netsedaton's idea was to how do we start training programs and healing programs in the community. Dunanai Ventures was looking at how do we access capital, how do we provide capital to provide economic opportunities for First Nations. And YIDC was to go out and start saying, look, we need development corporations, we need some of these institutions. And so they worked with each of the First Nation communities to develop development corporations because they didn't exist back then, which were really fundamental to looking at helping organize that. The other thing that we began to realize in Chapter 2, it talked about certainty because Canada, Yukon wanted certainty for business to be able to continue operating. And so we created the certainty clause, Chapter 2. But what we learned after a while is that certainty is not created by a chapter in the agreement. Certainty is actually created by interaction with the land, what the elders have always said. We have to interact with the land and the water in a good way, and that's where you create certainty because mines need access to resources, lumber, businesses need all this resources. But from a First Nation perspective, what you need to do is to ensure that the animals, the fish, the waters, the lands were protected. And it wasn't just a commercial kind of approach. And so what we began to do is that when Chapter 11 started to talk about land use planning was really an important kind of component. Our experience is that it hasn't been that successful to date, right? And it's not a criticism against the work that was done. It was where we started looking at where we were going and whatnot, because we've been not too successful with that process from our perspective. And I'll just speak a little bit from Carcross Tagus perspective. We're a transboundary First Nation. We have BC, you know, our territories in BC and the Yukon. And when you start looking at land and planning, Yukon doesn't have a mandate to talk to BC, BC doesn't have a mandate to talk to Yukon, Canada doesn't have a mandate. And you're starting to say it's really hard to land plan and to look at economic opportunities with two different or three different regulatory regimes that oftentimes aren't talking to each other. So we learned a lot in some of these processes. So what we began to do is we started saying, look, we wrote a letter of assertion, basically saying we can't rely on other governments to exercise and to protect our rights. We need to be proactive. We need to work with other governments. We need to figure out how to assert our rights, and in a good way, not a mean way. I think a lot of people were worried. So what we said is that one of the ways that we want to do this assertion of rights is to actually look at a planning process and interaction with the land and the water. And so we begin to start developing a process to begin to start saying, how do we take Indigenous traditional knowledge and make that the fundamental focus point of a land planning process, right? So we're giving the elders, and it picks up on some of the things that Dave talked about that, you know, the elders always talked about, is that knowledge, traditional knowledge, Indigenous knowledge has to be the foundation of how we move forward, right? So we've begun to pick that up. And so when we started looking at land planning and whatnot, we had a proclamation. One of the things we recognized is that oftentimes mining companies, their first stop is not to Yukon or BC or Canada government. It's to a First Nation government to start saying, we have an interest in mining properties, or we're looking at an interest in here, you know, what's you guys' perspective and whatnot. And so we've encouraged that. So a proclamation, we're developing databases, all these types of things to start getting data, because any economic opportunities in land planning and water planning has to be based on data. But a lot of the gaps in the existing data with the governments are a lot of that traditional knowledge, where berry patches are. Now, it might sound funny, but berry patches feed the grouse and the ptarmigan, feed the lynx and it feeds the moose. We all know this, right? And those are really critical areas. So we're coming up with different approaches in terms of looking at and encouraging governments, organizations, people that are looking for economic opportunities to connect with us, to start engaging in sort of a planning process of where we begin to look at things. So that's one piece that we're starting to do, is to start and implement it. So we're almost past the institutional building stage in terms of the treaties and into the implementation stage. So when we started talking about Chapter 19, and we started talking, Dunn and I Ventures didn't, you know, we didn't have money to do economic development. Part of the compensation that Dave talked about set up trust companies. And so we have loose organization. It's not a formal organization where the Yukon self-governing First Nations that have trusts have sort of a loose sort of meeting every now and then to talk about how do we invest in our communities. A lot of our monies, you know, which is quite substantial, is invested in international projects or international government development, that type of thing. And we're trying to look at our adjusting our policies to say how do we invest in our communities. What's important about that is when you try to access capital, you're thinking differently. When you're actually investing, it's a different thought process, right? And so you have to shift. There's a mind shift that is required, where you're starting to look at, one is that, you know, risk is really important. So we started looking at that in terms of how do we mitigate risk, especially if we're going to invest in projects like energy projects or in Intelcom or these bigger projects. One of the things we learned from YDC is that you have to make way as the First Nations evolve and develop. So YDC took the, you know, if a First Nation wanted to invest in a business, because we initially invested in businesses local, and when the First Nations are ready to take it on, you have to back away, right? And you have to look at bigger projects, bigger initiatives. We're at the point now where a lot of the First Nations, if collectively they work together, are pretty significant projects we're talking about that would shift the economics of the Yukon if we can coordinate it. And there's a lot of things to talk about, but I won't talk too much about them. Canada's response to the Brundtland Commission was Yukon Council, Economy and Environment, the National Roundtable. Those are vehicles that when you sit and have dialogue, create a dialogue forum like this, is actually where a lot of solutions start coming from. So very much those are things that are needed. The last thing in terms of economic opportunities, Chapter 19 turns into that, where we start looking at, okay, if you have a good, solid, interactive land, water planning process, and you know where opportunities can occur, where sacred spots are, where habitat protections are, right? That land plan allows economic opportunity. So in chapter 22, it's very important, because what it begins to do is it begins to start saying we need to be engaged in the economics, we need to be engaged in contracts. Right now, a lot of those contracts are, you know, it sets, you know, for our treaties, it sets a certain volume amount. We're now actually talking about larger contracts when you start talking about internets and cables and all these kinds of things. And we have the capital to do it, right? And I think if we create the forum, is that collectively, if the First Nations look at the next level organization, you start saying, how do we invest in our communities? A lot of the work that was done with our elders to lay the foundation, a lot of the institutional building that we had looked at to sort of build the infrastructure institutions to be able to do this are now at the hand. And I start looking towards those younger ones to start saying, it's your turn, right? We need to take it to the next level, right? We have the ability to invest. We have the ability to make laws. We have the ability to land plan. So let's get organized. Let's figure out how to do it to the next level. Not looking at anybody in particular.
Thank you, Mark. A number of the points you made about planning, Yukon Council on the economy and the environment, and so forth, we're going to come back to with other speakers, and I invite you to come back into the discussion at that point, okay? Now, the next speaker is actually in Montreal. So Rich Thompson of NVD is, I hope, going to join us by Zoom, and I have a couple of questions for him if we're able to bring him right across the country.
I am here, Tony.
How are you, Rich?
I'm doing well, thank you. And I'm back in Calgary now, so I'm a little...
Oh, are you? Okay. My apologies. I said I have two questions. That wasn't one of them. The first question I want to ask is if you could very briefly talk about MVD's history of relationships with First Nation development corporations and just a little kind of story about how that came about and how it's going. And then I have a second question for you.
Sure, Tony, I'd be happy to do that. And I'll try and be fairly brief, but offer some important points. The vision of Northern Vision when we first came to the territory didn't have a lot to do with First Nations in its initial form. We thought about connecting up Southern capital with Northern opportunity, and that was about as far as our vision went. But the first 5 or 6 years that we were in the Yukon, we became very aware of the fact that because of a lot of the things that you've been talking about here today, the First Nations represented both an important investor, important community driver for anything that we might wish to do in the North. And our CEO in the initial stages and now chairman of our company, Pierce McDonald, who had been involved with you back in the day when the framework was being negotiated, he shared his vision with us that we could very much grow our vision to include involvement of the First Nations. And so in 2012, we invited First Nations to get seriously involved with us. Up until that point, the YIDC had made an investment, the Inuit had made an investment, but really hadn't had much of a presence from First Nation investors. And we realized in talking to the First Nations that they were a perfect fit for what we wanted to do, or perhaps we were a perfect fit for what they wanted to do, because they shared a longer-term view to investing, a patient capital view to investing, a community orientation to investing, which are all things that are extremely important to NVD. So we reached out and asked the First Nations if they would like to get involved with us. And because of their structure, which included trusts that were governed well and looked for a fair return on investment for their citizens, development groups that were well situated within the communities and able to identify opportunities and to take a bigger risk in community development initiatives, the need overall for the First Nation communities to see an appropriate level of growth in the areas that we were involved in, real estate, hotels, now assisted living and other things. The combination of those things, Tony, meant that we were great position to partner up. And we have over the since really 2012, when the First Nations took a meaningful stake in our company and started owning about 30% at that time, and they've grown that stake up to 48% now, probably over 50% when you consider that we have joint ventures with various First Nation Development Corps. Since 2012, we've partnered in the communities where our First Nation partners are active, in Carcross, in Carmax, in Mayo, in Dawson, in Whitehorse, making investments where we join together. And our hope in joining together that we'll develop a, and when I say joining together, it's typically a 49-51 or a 50-50 joint venture in specific projects. And it's our hope that we'll understand the need a little better and be able to serve the community a little better by being in partnership with groups are even more invested in those communities than we are by virtue of their understanding of the community, their presence there, their the fact that their citizens work, live, and play in those communities, learn about opportunities and be more mindful about what makes sense to invest in, and benefit a little in joining forces with us by our deeper capabilities in some of the commercial areas, our accounting depth, our management depth, our understanding of certain business processes, and we think it's a pretty powerful combination. It worked well for us, and lately it's been the most common way in which we've been investing, because we find that the best investments we can make are in partnership with our First Nation partners, and so that is essentially the way it's evolved over time, and it was driven part by opportunity that presented itself by us just being in the marketplace and by the foundation that had been laid that you've been talking about earlier in this conversation, and in part by the vision of Pierce McDonald, our chairman, who he always had the view that we could do a lot if we were oriented towards partnership, and so we've tried to follow that guidance.
Rich, thank you very much. Let me ask you the second question, which is a much shorter one. A colleague of yours has asserted that if it weren't for the development corporations, the land claims capital, and the investments that you and others have made with them, the Yukon economy in the first decade of this century would have been in very serious trouble. Would you agree with that proposition?
I would completely agree with that assessment, Tony. There's no question.
Okay. Thank you very much, Rich.
Okay. No problem.
Being with us. I'm now going to go to another Yukon entrepreneur who has worked with the communities here and ask you, Wendy, if you talk about a little bit of a history of your work with your First Nation. You said? Yes. With the First Nations you work with company. If you could. Thank you.
Thanks, Tony. Great to see everyone. Certainly honored to be here and included. Some of you may not know much about us. Alcan Air is an aviation company in Yukon, founded back in 1977. We do primarily air ambulance and exploration and mining in the Yukon, but we also have a sector in BC now, so certainly growing there as well. So to give you a bit of background, I'm the majority shareholder now and have been probably since 2012. But in 2013, we started having a conversation about where do we want to take the company in the next decade and who do we want to partner with as we move forward. And our company works in every single corner of this territory. So we quickly realized the best partners to work with were the ones within each of the traditional territories. And as you were speaking about earlier, Dave, the existence of the DevCorps is critical because that's exactly who we stepped out and had conversations with. We wanted to find a way to partner with them in a way that was stable return and reasonably low risk in the early days, and looked at that twofold. One, wanted to see all of the territory that was interested in doing so to participate in aviation, because as we all know, it's a critical part of the infrastructure in the north. And two, I can't say I'm a multi-generational Yukoner because I moved here at a week old, but I'm very passionate about education for Yukoners. And I wanted to highlight aviation for the five-year-olds across our territory. So one was an investment component, making sure there was that partnership there. And two was making sure the five-year-old in various parts of the Yukon saw the idea of being a pilot or being a mechanic as a real opportunity. So we started talking to DevCorps, and very pleased that in 2014, three of them, so Chief Isaac, Trondek, Nutternight Dunn, and Kelowna First Nation, acquired an aircraft and got into the aircraft leasing space. And as I say, it's a great opportunity from an investment perspective because it's a very stable return and quite low risk. So they bought an aircraft, leased it back to us in 2014, and then again in 2016, Nacho Knight Dunn and Kelowna First Nation acquired another aircraft, leased it back to us, and that one flies primarily at a Mayo, but also at a Whitehorse. And I can't say too much yet, but this week we'll be doing another announcement. We're fortunate to have four First Nations DevCorps that have acquired a couple more aircraft and are continuing to partner with us. We see this as an important piece for Alcan and for aviation in the Yukon and a great opportunity from an investment perspective. But the investment piece didn't do everything we wanted as far as engaging the five-year-olds. Back in 2016, we opened a flight school in Whitehorse, and really our focus was training Northerners to fly in the north. I'm sure everyone here knows, if you travel on airplanes, that there's a pilot shortage. We thought that was coming in 2016, and we all know it's very real today. So when we started that school, it was really about how can we help Yukoners get access to aviation training right here in the territory. And excited, over the next couple of years, we're hoping to get out, take that flight school into the communities across the Yukon and provide education right within the communities. Because although we have a flight school in Whitehorse, which is great, that doesn't necessarily do everything we need to do as far as ensuring every Yukon child actually has access to aviation flight school training. So, so that's where we are today. We've got lots of things we're still looking to do.
You hinted at the future, but you're not announcing.
There's a couple other things I'd like to share with you, actually. So, one of the things we did a couple of years ago and going to do again is First Nations 101 at the Yukon University. I'm sure some of you know that exists. It's a great program for people that are new to the Yukon. And I'll be honest with you and tell you that we put our entire company through it a couple of years ago, and we have many lifelong, multi-generational Yukoners who really didn't understand our history. So that's a great program and a great opportunity to engage all Yukoners in understanding our history. And one of the other things that I think a lot of businesses are doing today is moving forward with hiring consulting firms. We've certainly done that to help us understand. We don't know what we don't know. So we're very interested in partnering with the First Nations DevCorps and with the First Nations. And as Rich said, actually looking at going towards not just the passive investment of the aircraft, but actually being involved in the operation, having a seat at the table, as somebody said to me, which to me just means you get to stay up and worry about payroll alongside me, but that's okay. But yeah, really figuring out how to involve different First Nations and First Nations DevCorps in the actual operational side of our company. But we don't necessarily have all the skill set needed to have the conversations necessary with the various DevCorps and First Nations. So it's great that there are organizations like that we can now reach out to and can help us navigate that. And I would just kind of echo what Rich said as far as the first decade, but more importantly, the next decade. The Yukon First Nations procurement policy has certainly changed business in the Yukon and how private business is engaging with the First Nations DevCorps. And I see 10 years from now a significant role economically. When you talk about transforming Yukon's economy, I think that's very much something that will happen with the DevCorps. So the next decade, I'm hoping we can focus on working with the First Nations DevCorps for the North, by the North.
Thank you very much, Wendy. Now, Mr. Tim, Mark talked about land, rural setting. I want to now go to Les Wilson and talk about Quanlin Dunn's Development Corporation, the challenges they had in terms of attempting a land registry, and then where they're going in terms of housing and land development in an urban setting, which of course requires a relationship with the city of Whitehorse and others.
Thank you. I'm Les Wilson. I feel kind of honored that I'm actually sitting around this table with these powerhouses here. I really feel like I should be, to be honest. I should be in the back. But as Mark mentioned, I am actually one of the implementation individuals that actually took the final agreement and really tried to really squeeze as much as we possibly can out of it. Now, from what I gather, I wasn't a part of the negotiation team, but at the time, I was sort of a fly on the wall in the back room of one of the land claims departments. And from what I gather, the only real chapter that was really able in terms of actually trying to change things since it actually got to us was Chapter 22. So from what I gather, we at our negotiation team put in some specific provisions on top of the general provisions that is largely made out of the umbrella final agreement, specifically for economic opportunities in the city of Whitehorse. Again, at the time, one of them happened to be alternative energy for the most part, right? And that's where we got to meet Yukon Energy Corporation when they approached us about the opportunity to potentially put in a 25% equity stake in a project that they were doing that was about $42 million at the time, around 2013, around the same time when I was moved into the Economic Development Department from the Land Claims Department. This particular opportunity had to be realized through the gills of a corporation that did not exist at the time. There was one in place, but I think the capacity was at a level that just wasn't going to be able to go ahead and take this particular opportunity to where it really needed to go. That the Chinookwan Development Corporation was born out of that particular project. That was the backup generators at the bottom of the south access, right? So the corporation was incorporated in 2016, and since then, we've been working with our shareholder and in concert, essentially, with Kwanlindun to unlock the economic potential of Kwanlindun's lands in the city of Whitehorse. Now, just like some other very fortunate First Nations in Canada, location is key, right? Some of those very fortunate First Nations like the West Bank and Osoyoos just happen to be in a portion of Canada that's very rich, right, in terms of just about all kinds of resources, not to mention just cash. But certainly in Whitehorse, we were poised for an incredible opportunity given the land quantum within the city of Whitehorse itself, and of course the fact that most of the land is of a topography that's very it's hard to develop. So Kwanlindun was very fortunate. I commend the negotiators at the time for picking very key pieces of land that we're just now unlocking right now, in fact. So we waited for quite a long time to basically establish a Lands Act. That came out in 2020. We started that a few months after we ratified the agreement in 2005. So it took a significant portion of effort for the First Nation to go ahead and get that and establish that document, that legislative instrument. But in terms of up until then, we really focused on the commercial and industrial lands within the city of Whitehorse because there was a specific tax cliff under chapter, I think the tax chapter. 15 and 20 years after the final agreement was ratified, these particular portions of land were going to be taxed just like everything else. So there was basically a moratorium on property tax at the time. So that was the fire under our butt to really go ahead and try to get these out to market. We've done that, I think, to the most part. We've been doing it quite quietly, in fact, and that's calculated, really. We got enough to do. We got a small corporation, but we've got a significant portion of a business, the Hammerstone Business Park in Coolan, if anybody is aware of that. We've essentially sold 9 lots there out of 31. I'm still working on the remaining of the subdivision. We got some lots that we've sold at market price up in Coolan, and we got some in SEMA. We've opened up, of course, another subdivision based on our opportunity with Yukon Energy Corporation with the battery, which happens to be apparently the largest battery in Canada, from what I gathered, not just Northern Canada, right? That's situated on Robert Service Way on a portion of Kwanlindun land under the self-government agreement was meant for industrial anyhow. So with that long-term lease, we're able to go and build and construct a subdivision. Now, we're pretty much broke in that particular subdivision, but at least we got 5 other lots ready to go, right? So then, of course, another opportunity that's not in the final agreement was the Heckle Hill project. That was born out of a lunch with me, Rick, and a very fine young fellow out of Vancouver that really does this type of stuff for all over Canada. So that was a 100% federally funded project up here that's going to benefit the entire community of Whitehorse and, of course, the Yukon as well, right? It's not on settlement land, but it's certainly that's certainly a nice feather in Chinookwan's hat, right? Another one, Chapter 22 benefit that was realized was the gravel resources. From what I understand, Rick was talking to several negotiators years ago that we needed gravel resources And he was kind of a little bit laughed at the time because nobody really realized just how valuable that was. We have now turned two gravel pits, three of them, in fact, actually, in the city of Whitehorse, were into highly, an extremely good revenue source for the corporation. We have now moved to, I think we're almost 50% of the revenue sales in the city of Whitehorse, and reaching more than that over the next couple of years as we expand our pits right now. So that's an amazing opportunity. In terms of residential development, again, the Lands Act did not come out till 2020, but we fought really hard and worked together with the then director of lands to essentially open up a condo unit on Jarvis Street, which was already fee simple, essentially. So there was already a certificate of land titles within the land titles office that allowed us to do that, so we could sort of circumvent the Land Titles Act. Again, at that time, none of the banks would look at us. We had to fully fund that personally inside the corporation. Now, again, it was a bit of a risk for us, but at the same time, we knew it was going to happen. It was going to happen at some point. So I'm glad to say that those four units have all sold at market price, and they've actually, a couple of them, already turned some hands. Right now, in the what's going on in the public realm right now in the city of Whitehorse, in terms of zoning and subsequently the subdivision, is a large, roughly 200 residential lots we're putting up in Copper Ridge. Right, these will be for market price as well, and for the general public as well, that the citizens of Kwinana just happen to be a part of that as well. So just some of the stuff that we've been up to. Thanks.
Thanks, Les. Given the housing shortage, that's important work and great achievements. I'll turn the page a little bit now. Chapter 22 actually mentions the Yukon Development Corporation and the Yukon Energy Corporation, and how I think it is 25% of the directors should be First Nation. I think that's not the case right now. But Ed Schultz, on the wall in his office, I'm going to tell you a secret, has this big map of all the energy prospects in the Yukon Territory. And, okay.
No, I'm kidding.
And all the First Nations that are involved in different ideas and different plans for those projects. And Ed, I wanted to see if you would talk about some of those.
Certainly. Certainly good to see all my old friends and my more recent ones and the younger generation. Let me just first say the Chapter 22 review is really through my office and with my staff, like Peter and Jess, are working with your representatives from your communities to conduct us through review through GUNTA, and I want to thank GUNTA as well. But here's the thing. Canada looks at Chapter 22 and wants to strike it off and say it's done. Period. My interpretation of Chapter 22, it ain't never done. It's never finished. Just like every other chapter in our final agreements. You can't just do a check mark and say, oh, we're finished, we have no more obligation. One of the principal things in Chapter 22 is to be ensuring that we're participants in this economy. How are we going to get there? Back in the day, as I recall it, was we already knew that our people were already not equal to other Yukoners and other Canadians to participate in this economy. We did not have the right educational opportunities, we did not have the investment capital, but more importantly, we did not have the respect of other people. Well, that's increasingly changing with young people like Wes here and others. But what I can say is that if there's a thought here that in this exercise of reviewing Chapter 22, at least from our perspective, when we're done with this review, it's going to identify what we need to continue doing and how to improve the things we already are doing, but we ain't ever going to be done with it. And we're never going to agree with anyone or any of the other parties that say, okay, we checked it off the list. It's done. Because contemplation there is that we'd be partners in perpetuity with the rest of Yukoners and the rest of Canadians in this economy. And once you achieve that, then you have to maintain it. Right? But one of the things that I want to share with you, which I shared with Tony, he saw my, anyone who's been to my office know I have a big whiteboard, I always do, because I'm going blind and I need it that big. But I try to map out everything, and I'm a bit of a nerdy guy, and I like to look into things that in a lot of detail. But here's something I want to share with you. And there is that reference to the Yukon Energy. In the assessments that we've been doing in my office with my team and in our discussions with Canada through various instruments like the development of the Canadian Northern Arctic Policy Framework, when you look at the objectives of Canada's greenhouse plans or climate change reduction to 2050 or Yukon's 2030 or the 10-year plan for Yukon Energy Corp, you start looking at all these things. You look at what you want to do. You want employment, you want education, you want investment, you want food security, you want to reduce your carbon footprint, you want to do all those sort of things. And there's one place it all converges, and it's on my whiteboard. It's energy security. Energy security for our communities. Because you have to remember that we are already on an isolated grid that can barely meet our demand now. All the great things we're doing, either as individuals or through our corporations, quite frankly, in the big scheme, and Mark and I have had a discussion about this, is a Band-Aid. It's not a long-term solution for us. If the population escalations are going to be hold true as they are projected, not only for other Yukon people coming here, but for even for our own growth, we have to do something different. Now, I want to lend this to your ears. Interestingly enough, the Yukon government now wants to work on geothermal legislation. 2 years ago when I was bringing it up and advocating it, it was, oh, Yukon Energy Corp didn't want to talk about it. YG didn't want to talk about it. Oh, it's off the table. But we know that the Canada Geological Society has been working with some of our communities and some individuals and have been doing some testing up in Kaska country. I don't know the results there, but I do know about the White Horse Trough between Carcross and Minto. Is that you got one of the shallowest access points for geothermal anywhere on this continent. Generally speaking, to get geothermal, you're going to 6,000-7,000 meters. Right where we're sitting right now, it's 3,000 meters to get that average temperature of 120 degrees Celsius all year round, even if it was minus 100 degrees Celsius on the surface. The beauty about geothermal is that it's one of the lowest power, it's one of the lowest ways to generate power with the least amount of O&M cost. There's no doubt the front end costs more. But we're not talking, I'm not talking about building a geothermal plant in Iceland for $400 or $500 million. They come in scales. There's the large ones, there's the medium-sized ones, and then there's the small-scale geothermal. All geothermal plants, which are already built around the world, which you could build anywhere from the price range from $6 to $15 million, will power 600 houses all year round. And will not contribute one iota to greenhouse gas contributions to climate change. We have solutions here, and we have big problems. The problem is I think there's too many people thinking that either one group or the other is going to fix it. The reality is it's going to take all of us here to fix it. Indigenous people, new Yukoners, old Yukoners, we are the solution, and we have the capital, we have the means, we have the ability to do this thing and solve our problem, not only for energy, but here's the thing. Every community should have a target to ensure that you have energy security to run all essential services, your water plant, your heating systems, you know, emergency services, etc. Make sure your pipes don't freeze up and it doesn't cost you $50,000 to replace one home, right? Then you need to generate a bit more, so maybe now you could heat your homes, your community buildings. Generate even more, you can grow food all year round in a heated greenhouse. And anything after that, due to the way the laws are today, You can sell any excess back onto the grid as economic development. And you're creating employment in a different sector, which is very weakly represented by our people right now. We have a number of people that are climbing poles and stringing line or slashing. But why aren't we further up the ladder in this system? You know, we have the opportunity here, I think, as a region to really insulate ourselves from a lot of problems that we witnessed even this summer. You know, we have the same as holds true with the communication system. There's no one group I think is going to solve it, in my opinion. It's going to take us all. And the reason why I'm sharing this with you is because Chapter 22 needs to fixate on something. It needs to focus on something, something that's doable, achievable, and merits serious consideration. And I believe this does. I think we have an opportunity to solve our problem once and for all and set a global example that this could be done. Because the reality is until some jurisdiction as small as ours actually does it, bigger jurisdictions will continue to say what they were saying up to me up till 2 years ago. That's impossible. We could never do geothermal. We can't solve it. Anyways, I guess my old politician's coming out. I really wanted to make certain that we understand that there's also, I just want to close on this point. When I look at what's already written in all those various plans, goals by the federal government, and even the stuff that we're working on now in contributions to the current draft, rolling draft of the Canadian Arctic Policy Framework, they're going to dump a buttload of money in this sector soon. Billions of dollars. If you don't start getting your game plan together, you're going to miss the boat. Other jurisdictions are either going to take up the money, or the current system we have now takes it up just to reinvest with band-aids and trying to keep old infrastructure running. So in any event, that's the contribution I was asked to make, because Tony saw my whiteboard and said, you have to share that. and I encourage everyone to really think about this, because we need, aside from the review and the analysis of how well certain provisions of Chapter 22 have been conducted or not, you should still have an aspect of this review that speaks to what should you do next, what should you take on next, and how important is it for everybody for such a thing to happen. So anyways, that's the 2 cents I've been asked to give. Mussy.
2 cents, a lot more than that, a lot more than that. Speaking of money, several mentioned the procurement policy, the one that took a long time to gestate. Some recent comments about how it was very much focused towards capital rather than service contracts. Peter is a former Chamber of Commerce guy now working with First Nations on economic questions like this. Could you comment on where we're going on procurement?
Yes, thank you very much. I appreciate it. I just want to say and sort of echo my former colleague from Kwanlin Dunn's observations. I'm honored to sit at this table with the people that are sitting around it. These are the people that shaped the territory that we live in today. So thank you very much for that. As Tony said, the early results from the launch of the Yukon First Nations procurement policy would give the appearance that the procurement policy is primarily focused on First Nations participation in Yukon government capital projects, rather than also including the delivery of professional services such as IT expertise, engineering or architectural services, and other Yukon government procurement needs. This perception is probably a result of the efforts that the Yukon government has undertaken to build awareness for the procurement policy by going out to individual communities and talking about their plans for capital spending in the coming years. They've been going around on a roadshow, essentially delivering description of what they plan to do over the next 5 years in each community's area. All well and good, good stuff, but there hasn't been a similar sort of exposure for the opportunities in terms of procurement that are related to professional services. The procurement policy definitely includes higher the Yukon government to have Yukon First Nations businesses participate through the procurement policy on professional service tenders as well as capital projects. And then beyond that, there are also community development agreements and other projects that are underway. And just like with the capital projects, the bid value reduction calculations, which take into consideration the level of participation by First Nations businesses in terms of the workforce, the geographical region in which they're working, and other aspects like that, those same bid value reduction calculations will apply to professional services that are pursued as well as for the capital projects. So I would say, you know, the critical elements for success for the Yukon First Nations procurement policy in both professional services tenders and maybe even more so in professional services tenders than some of the capital projects really involve, you know, the capacity and workforce development piece of the picture, awareness building out to the communities of the both procurement policy or process and the opportunities, and then finally the development within individual First Nations of the resources to be able to know what skill sets reside within their individual communities and who the people and the businesses are within their individual community who are most likely to be a good fit and a benefit from the procurement policy. So it's far more than just digging ditches and paving roads. We need to keep that in mind.
Peter, we're now gonna do a little bit of a shift from business and businesses to working people and training and employment opportunities. So I want to go first to our good friend, the president of the First Nation Chamber of Commerce, Mr. Drapeau. You're with us, I see. But I want to ask him a question not from a Chamber of Commerce point of view. I want to ask him a question as a former territorial government and federal government employee. One of the provisions of Chapter 22 is a representative public service. And in some of his comments, Albert has made the point that while there are policies in place, there still exist barriers to employment for Indigenous people. And I wonder if I can get you to talk about that, please.
Thank you, Tony. Apologies that I can't be there today. Couple things. With Chapter 22, there are a couple of requirements with the representative public service plan that was supposed to be created for the federal and the territorial governments. When I was with Nachinyak Dun Development Corporation 20 odd years ago, we worked on that plan for the First Nation of Nachinyak Dun. Moving forward, the federal government has, has done the First Nation recruitment for Aboriginal people to be included in their workforce. I feel that more could be done in order to get First Nation people at all levels rather than entry level. So there can be improvement done on that. With Yukon government recently, they have adopted the Yukon First Nation recruitment where all job or employment opportunities are open and preference will be given to Yukon First Nation people. However, the barriers that come into play there is anyone can apply. It's the types of questions that are specific to Yukon government that will weed out Yukon First Nation participation within the recruitment process. So what I'm trying to get at is if you are trying to seek potential employees from outside of Yukon government, you have to be aware that they may not know Yukon government policies or priorities because they are not part of the system. Questions in the interview process that are specific to those priorities will eventually weed them out and will not be able to be successful in the recruitment process. So it would be interesting to have the number of stats of number of Yukon First Nation applications, how many have made it through to or shortlisted, how many have gone through the written exercise, and how many have gone through the verbal, and how many was actually recruited. So that piece is the accountability piece. And I guess one recommendation is if you are trying to recruit First Nation people from outside, look at your questions. What is it that you're actually looking for? Are you looking for skills, their ability? Then those recruitment questions should be geared towards the skills and recruitment rather than YG specific priorities and policy, because outsiders won't know that.
Well said, Al. Well said. Thank you. We're going to move on to the question now of apprenticeships. And first of all, I want to introduce, bring into the conversation Ted Huppay. Now, some of you may know Ted as the president of the Yukon Association of Education Professionals, but part of his glowing history is not only is he an Indigenous person, Métis, but he's also a former tradesman, a journeyman carpenter. And one of the provisions of Chapter 22 talks about flexible apprenticeships. And it is fairly clear that that has not happened. So can I talk to you first? We've got a couple of other people who are going to come in this conversation, Ted, but I'd like you to talk a couple of things too about flexible apprenticeships and experiential learning, what that means, what it means for Northern Indigenous people, and then I'm going to go to some people who are actually directly interested in that matter. Okay.
Thank you, Tony. From my observations and from my being an educator in the Yukon Territory for the past 30 years, I'm seeing that very little has changed. I began my apprenticeship in 1979. My high school experience was very traditional. You did your full matriculation, you were on an academic pathway, and there was no options. We're seeing that now, and we're seeing that today, where most of our school programming, whether you are in Whitehorse or in rural communities, have an academic pathway, and there is only one pathway. We have 20% of our graduates going to post-secondary education. Those numbers haven't changed. And we then have 80% of our school graduating population, if they graduate, moving into the workforce. If I think about my own experience, if I think about what I see in Whitehorse and in the Yukon, we have a vast, underutilized, untapped resource. We need to give purpose to our education. And when Tony talks about flexible apprenticeships, in the academic pathway, you can get dual credits for your academic courses at Yukon University and high school credit. That has not happened up to this point in apprenticeships. And if you want to think about a young person growing up in any rural community, as I grew up in a rural Saskatchewan town, there were very few options. And if you actually had purpose, we're talking to someone about from Alcan Air, talking about exposing youngsters to the aviation industry. Well, it's not any different for the trades. If we gave purpose to our young people and gave them insights to the opportunities that are available in the trades. And I'm not just talking carpentry. I'm a Red Seal carpenter. I did that before I went back to school. But opening up the doors for youngsters, for teenagers to understand that there is a world out there that is available to them. When I talk about purpose, we're talking about exposing young people to purposeful math, purposeful science, education that has application. So much of our science, so much of our math is theoretical. It's not applicable. I talk to my son all the time, and I say, I learn more from my geometry and my physics in relation to my construction experience than anything else because I had purpose. So when we talk about flexible apprenticeships, we need to expose our young people to programming that has purpose, that enables them to dive into a trade, give them purpose during their high school years so they actually stay in school. Our retention rate is deplorable in the Yukon, and we've got to get find a way to make sure our kids stay in school, have purpose, and I believe a flexible apprenticeship program would give them that purpose, give them that desire to stay in school, and a reason to stay in school.
Thank you, Ted. I'm going to go now to Jeff Sloychuk, who's not on the original speakers list, but is with the Building Trades Council, president of the Building Trades Council here, and I'm going to let him do a mini interview with a young First Nation person pondering an apprenticeship or starting an apprenticeship.
I'm not sure he's that young anymore, but okay.
He looks very young, though.
Well, thanks, and thanks very much to Ted, and thanks to all of our honored guests and members of the panel here, friends and allies. So Jeff Sloychuk is the name, as Tony said, and Ted provided a really nice introduction, because what we've done with the Carpenters Union and the Yukon Building Trades is specifically worked on partnerships with First Nations to do these sorts of alternative or flexible apprenticeship type programs. And I'm sure some of you would remember the Tidy Homes project with the Cargas Tagus First Nation, which then led into an elder maintenance program, which then led into building the Learning Center. My brother and colleague, Richard Atlin Jr. beside me, went all do all those jobs and actually had a part in building that incredible building on along the highway and along the lake in Carcross. And I guess, Richard, I just put to you, like, what was it about our program that helped you and your colleagues and our brothers and sisters in the program, what was it about that made apprenticeship just work better for you?
Well, for me, I would think that it was just the fact of being acknowledged and noticed and listened to, you know, and actually taking theory and put it to practice, like practicum. Like in the morning, we'd be doing the theory and the math tests and stuff like that, and then we'd go and put it to practice in the afternoon, which was quite a shift and a change up. And instead of staying in class all day, it's good. And it helped out. It brought everybody together more. And most of all, for me, I think it's just being acknowledged, just to be noticed that there is people out there that really want the training and really want to go forth with it and do something with themselves and need some backing, I guess, some noticeability for sure. For me, yeah, I think that was good.
One of the things that has been said about Northern Indigenous training programs in the past is that they were too much focused on book learning and not enough on experiential practice. What was your experience in the program you did?
Well, I guess it's just more or less kind of like a step up from school. Like, I spent most of my life in school, I guess. I went right up to grade 12. I graduated in 96 and moved on from there. I've been always just in training. And for me, like, what we did was just kind of like a progression of that, I guess, just to, like, touched up on, just to make sure that we knew why we went to school and learned all the math and stuff like that. And we actually put the math to practice and actually made it work for us. So it's actually really good that way to actually put the training and see it all come to a complete and finished project.
What was the last project you finished?
For the Brotherhood Union, the union, I was working on the Learning Center in Cartgrass. We were there for 3 years.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, very quick.
I'm sorry, Tony. I just wanted to point out that when you go into an apprenticeship, you have to be able to prove that you have that grade 10 science and grade 10 math. That means there's no room for experimental grade 10 classes, say working out in the bush or doing traditional skills. It's only grade 10 biology, grade 10 this, grade 10 that. And when I pulled the transcripts, as you do when you're moving into an apprenticeship, of the 16 individuals working on this project, there was only two that had both grade 10 math, grade 10 science, Richard Atlin Jr. being one of them. Some of them were illiterate, and in one instance of one gentleman, because he had gone to residential school at Chutla, there was no records at all. It was appalling.
As I understand it, the math is relevant because you have to know Pythagoras, but science is probably not.
I could read you a few of these questions. I bet you none of us would get them.
Okay. So I'm going to go now switch to a huge question, perhaps the pivotal question in Chapter 22. Which Mark mentioned, and Ed referred to in terms of working together. And I'm now going to go to Gina to talk about the question of the Yukon Council on the economy and the environment. It says clearly in Chapter 22, there shall be. It indicates that this is not a government body, it's a public body, it's a citizen body, in which the Chambers of Commerce would appoint Chamber of Mines, Chamber of Commerce would appoint one-third of the people. The working people, unions, labor people would appoint one-third. Environmental organizations would appoint one-third. And First Nations would be guaranteed that they would appoint one-third. Not the government appoint them, these organizations, these groups would appoint them. For what purpose? Throughout Chapter 22, it talks about their purpose, involvement in reviews, planning, discussions about balancing economic and environmental interests, some of the things that Ed talked about in the energy sector. In 2008, the government, it looks like a broken treaty promise to me, but the government stopped appointing people. And in 2012, changed one word in one law and seemed to eradicate it altogether. But since it is a treaty commitment, I'm not sure how they could do that. But Gina, you've thought about this question. Could you talk about it a little?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Tony. I just want to say thank you for inviting me to the table. It is quite an honor to be amongst some wonderful trailblazers here in the Yukon that has taken us to Chapter 22 and the economy. And you talk about this particular Yukon Council. And for me, I think it's, you know, very vital to driving the economy and the environment together. You know, we need that. It should have, you know, the lens of our First Nations people at the table, you know, with Canada and Yukon to talk about economic planning. And we need to prepare for that. You know, at the end of the day, I say, so who's really steering the bus? You know, who's getting on the bus and where are we going? And I think we have to go back to that. And we talk about, you know, how do we move forward? What are the mandates, et cetera? I truly think from, you know, every community, from the sort of the bottom approach is we got to go back to that as the foundation of how we're going to go forward together.
Gina, let me go to another question, another chapter, which is not yet implemented in the UFA, which is Chapter 26. And the reason I'm raising the question of Chapter 26 is because in every discussion we've had about it, those of us involved, it created training opportunities and employment for Yukon people. And I'm going to ask Pat Dawes now, who was the former Public Service Commissioner of the Yukon, was intimately involved in mediation, alternate dispute resolution, labor relations questions in her Public Service Commission role, but she was also for some time a member of the Land Claims Dispute Resolution Board. And maybe I could ask you, Pat, do you know why it was never implemented? Do you know why we don't have this? Do you know why people are still complaining about spending millions of dollars on lawyers from the South?
Dispute resolution board isn't being used. The Chapter 26 is there to deal with issues under the agreement, and the whole idea was to have an informal way where we could have discussions and work through issues and come up with a mutual solution that was for both parties. And it would be all three parties, sorry. The whole idea was to have positive dialogue and resolution, and to not to go to the courts if we didn't have to. What's happened is I was on the board for 8 years, and there was only time the board was formed, there's only been 13 referrals. And so we have people that we've trained to be mediators and arbitrators. We've brought land claims negotiators, Dave Doe came and he's helped us, he's worked with us. We've developed the expertise in the territory to do the work, but for reasons that I don't understand why it's not being used. I know one thing I'm for sure is that when you go to court, you have a precedent-setting decision, but when you use mediation arbitration, it isn't precedent-setting. So that may well be one of the reasons it's not being used. But it really is a shame because you could do so much better and solve things in a different way with positive dialogue. And that's what was hoped for, and unfortunately it's not being used at this time.
Ms. Rainfray, it's related to the council and the economy and their farming question.
Yeah.
And of course, I shouldn't let this go, but I remember on your list of dispute resolution specialists was a guy named Mark Wedge, I think.
He was.
Yes, okay.
We recruit and we've got a really good roster of people. We've been trying to assist them with training and bringing in experts to help and make sure there's a full understanding. And so it's a really unique opportunity, and I think one that would do is to serve the Yukon very well if we could utilize it better.
Thank you, Pat, very much. So I'm now going to take the opportunity. We don't have that much time left, but some of you may have heard interesting comments by someone else on the panel. And I want to see if any of you want to make comments about anything else anybody had said, or perhaps ask them a question. And if we don't have any questions, I will go to our Zoom audience to see if they have any questions, okay? Gina. Now, Gina, I've been told to warn people at this stage, we don't have much time left. If you get tempted to make a speech, I shall have to rescue you by snatching the microphone out of your hand. So I'm going to say that to everybody. Very short or focused questions or comments, okay?
I just wanted to go back to the question and comment that Mark made about how do we invest in our communities? And it's a really good question because that's the work I do in communities, it's community safety. And we have to invest in our people first. And I come up with this thing called the economic gap, Indigenous economic gap. You know, we're very prosperous. We have development corporations. We have resource industry. We're very wealthy on one side. And the other side is, in reality, is we still have our citizens, our people struggling in our community from trauma, from residential schools, from historical impacts. And how do we move our people along the Indigenous economic spectrum scale, so they become part of that economic sustainability. So we really have to go back to look at investing in our people first, and seriously look at that as we go into community safety and addressing the issues in our own communities. So, and then you talk about education, you talk about training, et cetera. This is where it all comes together. So I just quickly wanted to share that. Thank you.
Brilliant point. Thank you. Anybody else want to make a comment, observation, or a question? If not, I'm going to go see if there's anybody on the Zoom board who has a question. Jesse, you have one? I won't be able to read that print that small.
I'm Kirk Cameron.
Why don't you read it out
loud? Kirk Cameron has written, Mark, can you speak to the importance of education and how the First Nations School Board is going to move the bar for Yukon students?
Is this for Mark Wedge?
I believe so, yes.
Okay. Mark Wedge?
Yeah, thank you. I think, and it goes back to, I think, Gina, a number of the things that we talked about. First Nation have not been that successful in graduating and working with the current educational colonial education system. And so I think as we start moving forward, we're beginning to start, Yukon University is beginning to talk about how do we indigenize university institutions. We're starting to talk about how do you look at an indigenous-based land and water planning process. We're starting to talk about different forms of beginning to look at education, both whether it's training or looking. And so I think what the school board is also recommending that, you know, it's based on what really the direction from the elders together today for our children tomorrow talked about the education, said if we can't accommodate it, we're going to have to start two systems, right? The idea is not to start two systems. We have the ability to have develop education acts and whatnot. First Nations want to work with governments, but governments have to be willing to start saying we need to think about it differently. And so I think that's where we're going. So the First Nations School Board is looking at that type of thing to start saying it's not just our citizens where we're trying to develop educational and different approaches to education. It's actually for all Yukon young people that a better way of learning.
Can I ask you a tough question, Mark?
I thought that was tough.
Well, tougher. So a lot of people I've heard say that some of the Indigenous languages in the Yukon are in real trouble. And the answer to that, we thought, back when Dave Joe was negotiating all this, these wonderful agreements, was that self-government was going to be the solution to that. But the First Nations School Board is not self-government. And is it sufficient government, though, to actually do language survival?
So I think really the direction at the school board is relying on the self-government. And in the backstop, every First Nation can develop their education act, start their own school, do all these things. That's not their intent. So the First Nation School Board is trying to negotiate, if you wish, between a Western system and traditional system and try to set it up for how it evolves, right? So that's one piece. Now, the other, when we start talking about language and whatnot, there are some good examples in Teslin, in Juneau, in different areas where language is starting to thrive. And that's not because of the programs that we've developed, it's because the First Nations has actually taken hold of it and started saying language is important for us and we need to do it. And we begin to start seeing that happen, right?
Thank you. Other questions? Ed.
I certainly agree with everything that Mark said, but we have to recognize that this First Nation Education Board is an interim step. It's not the end objective. It is something that we've been desiring to do way back when the Education Act first allowed for school boards. You know, we had the Catholic one and we had, you know, the other ones. We never did launch one for First Nations, so now we have. So it's taking advantage of what's in play now. What we really need in the long term is an educational system that blends our values, belief, customs, traditions, and our language, which is embedded in our languages, in a Western education curriculum that allows our people to be well grounded and healthy in their identity and proud of who they are, achieve like that young man. That's actually my cousin who was speaking over there. But, hey, cousin, so he's doing real well. But where they get that Western education in the sciences, the math, and all that sort of thing, and blends it with ours, and then excels with both, the best of both worlds. And I think that's ultimately what we want.
Let me give an opportunity. Anyone not in the panel, anybody in this outer circle have a question? Nope, then I'm gonna move quickly because we're running out of time. Dave, you have any comments? Nope. Grand Chief? So what I'm going to do now then is turn over the mic to former Grand Chief Judy Gingell, who's going to remind us all what spirit and intent is all about.
I gotta stand up when I talk. Just going back, and I always carry my little book with me because it really reminds me and takes me back and think about what it was all about. If some of you don't have this book, you need to have one. And have it on your desk. When you want to do something, read through it and think about it, because it tells you what our life was like then. What you see today was not there in my time when I got into politics in 1969. Prior to that, I was living under the Indian Act, being administered by a minister in Ottawa that tells me when to jump and how high to jump. It also told me when I married my non-native husband, I was not an Indian anymore. I lost my status under the Indian Act. And Tony shared with you what Elijah had to do and what he lost. And there was many others besides him, George Dawson, to send his children to the Whiters Elementary School had to be a non-status. So he gave up his status so he could send his children to the Whiters Elementary School. I could remember there was times when you read in this book, you're gonna see times, it's almost like a wish list. We wanna run a grocery store. I need a grocery store in Ross River. We need a grocery store in Mayo. We need this, we need that, and you'll see it all in here. People will tell you that when the Indians get a job here, they're only here for the first payroll. They're just there for the first check, and they're gone. There was no training provided for our people. We stayed at the labor level. We're always at the labor level, picking up the shovel and doing, to me, I think that's one of the hardest works. But we were always at that level. We never expand. Listening this afternoon, and I think most of you in this room could verify that it's coming down to where we respect one another for the best of the Yukon, and that's what these agreements were all about. I remember the elders sitting in that room, and I'm sure Dave also heard that, and Mark, because we were there. There were some people, some of our groups a little radical, want to get rid of all, and I'll use the words, want to get rid of all the white people. We own the Yukon. They got to go. The greatest respect, and we always work with and listen to them, was our elders of the day. They said, you can't do that. There's a big government that's running this Yukon territory. We can't do it all by ourselves. We are married to the non-Aboriginal people. They live with us. They're in our community. We have grandchildren from different races around this world. So you're not going to chase anybody out. Don't even go there or even think that way. This is the Yukon Territory, and we're going to share this land. We even want to take the government to court to prove them that this is our land. And the elder said, why do you want to go there and waste all that money and hire all kinds of people to prove that to the government? We know we own. We live here. We've always lived here. We know it. So let's move ahead. So there's, you know, I greatly appreciate a lot of those elders are not here with us today. But every time a situation comes, I go back and I think about what I heard in a lot of our land claims discussion. So to me, what I have witnessed and listened around this room, it's about sharing. It's about respect. I don't believe Yukon First Nation took anything away. We contribute. We've got the financial resources, we've got the land that we will work together and share and do what is best for our people here in the Yukon. But what is really missing, and we need to really buckle down and start working on that, is the whole implementation of these agreements. Every government, federal government, Yukon government, First Nation government, we sign those agreements. We come up with an implementation plan. Today, that's my journey. Everybody else said, when are you going to retire? I said, take me to a workshop, how to retire. I will never retire. I have a duty, and each and every one of you in this room also have that responsibility to implement the land claims agreement. So thank you for the 40 that met at minus 40, and that's what it's all about. Thank you.
So thank you, everybody who participated today, especially the people who were those whose handwriting and pens created the agreements. I want to thank also, especially the Gunter business team who have, as Ed reminded us, been doing the Chapter 16 review. This is part of that process. But today have made this event a success. Blair Hogan, Jesse Stephen, Emily, who's not here, and another young lady by the name of Stephanie Yassan Peniket. And there are also a number of very honorable, respected people in this room. I appreciate for them to coming to the discussion. I appreciate also for the large number of Zoom followers we had throughout. I'm sorry we didn't get any questions for them, but we didn't have the time anyway. So I would very much appreciate it if those in the audience might give a hand to our panel and also give a thank you to the Gunter team. Thank you. Masicho, Gunashchis, Sinicho.
And pretty soon I'm wondering.